SOC.
So,
what do you think about that? Is there any private sector involved? Private sector services? EPF, the Employment Provident Fund. So you see now, here all, you know, these guys are coming. And how are they coming? What is their contribution? We need to understand, you know, the private sector's contribution to social policy and social welfare policies, which is the main point or point of discussion for today. So delegated welfare activity. These are the words that you will see in the literature. That's why I'm using the same thing. Occupational welfare is very easy, right? Occupations, teaching, mining, whatever. So you see, these employees are taken care of, you know, and the private sector especially played an important role there. Delegated welfare activity, where the private sector acts as an agent of the government. In Korea, for example, the help. It's funded by the government, but the private sector, you know, delivers that service. Rapid finance, you know, it's a state, I think, initially, and then it is a private sector, or you know, you have a company or whatever they call. Rapid Penang, SDM, what do you call? SDM, PhD. Maybe then they ask for shares and, you know. So it is a delegated affair. The state is not directly involved, but it endorsed or it gave, you know, or it has given to a private sector, which acts as an agent of the government. Private firms also collect taxes on behalf of the government. That's what I was saying. The income tax, for example, job. It is under the, you know, under the private, but basically they enjoy certain monopolies, certain rights, which is given by the state. But then the idea is that, you know, they work hard, or they less corruption, less bureaucracy, less capism, whatever. So it's a delegated welfare activity. It is the state which is behind, but actual service is done by the private agencies, the private individuals, the private institutions. Can you think of anything else? For example, Penang Hill, it's a state property, right? Natural resources. But done by, I mean, the other services, the train and all that, you know, done by a private company, right? You know that?
Yes.
So this is delegated welfare activity. Then another type that we can see, engagement in policy making and process of government. A lot of private sector companies, for example, what else? They all influence the health policy and all that in this country, right? They are heavily involved in government policy making. And government will not make policy without consulting them, because they are big players in this. Housing, for example. Do you think government just make the policy without consulting your apartments, big, you know, these big companies that are there? Definitely they will, actually they are the ones who influence the policy.
Yes.
How much, you know, should be the space. What we mean by, you know, low income housing, you know, how much should be the cost. Private sector plays an important role. That's why US, it's all about corporations. It's all about, that's why it's a very good example of a liberal welfare. Even for the US presidential election, a lot of money is being spent by who? US presidential election, how much is money spent? I think few billion dollars, right? Where does this money comes from? Of course, from private sector and corporations. It's the open fact. When they put a lot of money and they get a president whom they want, definitely they will have influence on that. Though it will not look like that. So these guys are there, we need to recognize again. So they engage social policy, health policy, educational policy, housing policy, you name anything, they are there. So this is another area where we see private sector engagement or private sector involvement, or I would say even private sector influence, right? There's something called corporate social responsibility. We are all aware of this. Through that also they come into this picture, you know. Through this corporate social responsibility, the private sector, the private firms, the industries act to improve welfare of the communities in their vicinity, or the communities where they sell their products, or you know, whatever you call it. Basically, it's a responsibility that they're supposed to fulfill towards the community and its needs. Where private firms act to improve the welfare in the wider society. This includes both philanthropic activities, just giving, you know, clothes, giving some, you know, maybe you know, toys or whatever, philanthropic activities and compensation for external cost. The very idea of corporate social responsibility came because maybe you are a green or whatever industry, whatever you are green, still you are making or using the natural resources that belong to the community. So you are making this, you are using their resources, so you give them something back. Costs imposed by the firm, such as cleaning up the pollution or whatever. So through these mechanisms, the private sector is there. Maybe then you can add more. The private sector and privatization of social services, there's a lot of history. You can see that in many countries, even countries like Scandinavia, now many, many services are being privatized, given to the private sector. One of the most significant developments in 1990s, after globalization and all this, you know, global phenomena, you will see more and more involvement of private sector in these services. One of the most significant developments in 1990s in social policy in developing and transition countries has been the growth of privatization in health, education, water, basically water, I think you see a lot of things. Now education, health, transportation, telecommunications. Communication is a basic right. Do you think the Astro, what is that Astro? Don't you think it's private sector? Yeah. You don't have any other, you know. In India you have, I think India is the cheapest when it comes to the mobiles, the tariff. But there is in Malaysia, we don't have big players now. I think still under, you know, few monopolies, right? It is Dizzy and what else we have?
Maxis.
Yeah, Maxis, what else? Yeah, it's coming, slowly coming. But if you think there is only one company called Astro, which provides all the channels, what will happen? So basically, you know, policy in developing and transition countries has been the growth and privatizing health, education, water services, which involve the most of the Millennium Development Goals. When we are talking about Millennium Development Goals, all 8 or 9 goals, you will see the private sector, you know, participation. And big institutions like World Bank, Asian Development Bank, UNDP, they're all recognizing this, and there's a lot of collaboration and a place where actually the private sector can come in. You can see ODI, Overseas Development Institute, or UK, you know, or British funding, DFID, all of these guys are talking about private sector. Just type social policy and private sector, you will read a lot of things. In Malaysia, it's a classic example where actually private sector plays a very important role here. So we can't forget this, we have to realize this. We can see this, social policies and private sector participation in water supply. A very classic case, everywhere. You take Nepal or you talk about Iran or you take any country, when it comes to water, free common good, a huge resource, a basic element for life, private sector is there. Why do you think they're there? It was not there, you know, maybe 20, 30 years ago. But now, they're there. Good or bad, there are a lot of discussions on this. But the reality is that they are there. Now we, as social policy students, we need to understand what are their strengths, what is that they bring to the table, and what are the limitations, and how do we, you know, tackle this private sector participation, you know, for the common, you know, objectives. So this book talks about, for example, Malaysia started for private sector participation in the water sector in the 1990s, almost 20-30 years ago, mainly through BOT, buy, operate and transfer. You buy that, you operate for 20-30 years and again you transfer. That's all, I don't know what happens. All these toll gates and all that actually under BOT arrangement. You invest on the road, you make the toll gates, you collect the toll for the next 30-40 years, and maybe you again transfer back to the state, or maybe there will be another arrangement by then. So in recent years, this has been changing in favor of a concession type of contracts granted for longer periods. Many, you know, initiatives were under BOT, but now it is slowly changing. I don't know whether it's good or bad. Changing in favor of concession type contracts granted for longer periods. So you invest, government gives some concessions, you know, and then you manage that resource, and then you again, you know, hand over to the state or whatever. The private sector currently supplies water to 64% of the population in the country. You can check. Maybe it's not more. And I have other slides with you. I can show you. And this is reported in this UNRS, United Nations Research Institute for Social Development. It is in this, I quoted from this book. So we can start realizing what is the private sector participation in social services. This is what happening in Penang. This is Penang. This is a website screen capture that I've taken. I think in PBA Holdings is a public limited company that is based in Penang and Malaysia. The company was incorporated in the year 2000 and listed in the Malaysian or main board of the Malaysian. I don't know what is that, boss? Boos? Is it a Malay word or? Is it a stock exchange kind of thing? Yeah, it was listed there and now it is the main company which provides water in Penang. And Penang population is 1.6 million. There are about 468,000 housing units. But PBAP claims that it is serving about 500,000 consumers by supplying water 24 hours, 7 days a week in Penang. And that is the standard now. So what happens to other consumers there? When I say consumers, I don't know whether they have taken housing as a unit or I don't know what exactly. Maybe an industry is also a consumer. Maybe the whole Desa Permainda is just one consumer because we buy water, bulk water, and they supply again to all the flats. So we don't know exactly. But it looks like there are some people left out by PBA Holdings. It is not supplying 100%. So what's happening to them? Who is supplying water to them? Is it Public Works Department? Who is it? Any other idea? Where is this water coming from? I think we need to look into this. What's happening in rural areas? Okay. Well, Penang is a mostly urbanized state. One of the developed urbanized states. What about, say, Sabah? Or what about Kelantan? I'm not sure where it comes. There are, I think, 6 developed and then another 5 underdeveloped states in Malaysia. So what's happening there? What's happening in rural areas? Who is supplying water there? How much are they paying? Do they have access and quality services like their urban counterparts? These are the issues for us when we talk about social policy. And what is the private sector role there? Any idea now about water, access to drinking water? We can't even think of countries like Nepal. I don't think even they have a 24 hours, 7 days of supply. No, the water comes only 2 days in a week. The so-called the public supply. And then you can imagine what kind of water. This is fact. I've come from there, I've gone through that. We don't have a bath every day. Also, it's very cold, but also you don't have enough water. And you pay a higher price compared to here, for example. So this is like water industry all over the globe. It's there in India. It's many. I mean, you can think what's happening. Indonesia, I'm not sure. I've not done it. It's not a comparative social policy class. But if it is a comparative social policy class, I would have looked at what is the water supply in Indonesia. Who is supplying? What is the price? How many people get 24 hours, 7 days a week supply? These are the issues that becomes very interesting for social policy. Even in Malaysia, I'm sure not all states are enjoying the same thing. Why? What should we? Why state has given? Why the state of Penang has given this right or authority or whatever you call it to the PBA Holdings? And it happened in 2000, just 10 years ago. What was the water supply before 2000? How was that? Was that bad or good? What made Penang state to privatize this service? Whether there are any cost cuttings or when they gave this to PBA Holdings, what happened to those families or people who are working in this sector? Maybe they had to retire. I don't know what happened. So these are the things becomes important for us. It looks very good, right? On the my God, 24 hours, 7 days supply, serving so many consumers. They're even doing something in China or somewhere. It looks a great company, giving a lot of jobs. But the other side is what happened then, before 2000. Why the state had to do this? So we can go into that if you. But I'm not doing that here. I'm just trying to give you some ideas how a social work or social policy students should look into this. public sector participation, there are issues, but that's okay. When it comes to private sector, I think that becomes very interesting. We will not be very critical, even NGO services, the private, I mean the non-governmental services, maybe there are issues with that, the counseling, maybe a lot of NGOs are involved, right? But we don't look at very critically. What is that makes us very critical when it comes to private sector? Because we hate them, we don't like profits, or the very picture, privatization, has a very negative connotation because that is the experience that we had in the last 30, 40 years. What makes us to be very critical when it comes to private sector? That's what I'm asking from the beginning. We don't criticize, look very critically when it comes to state services, the public services, right? We don't very much criticize, we don't very much, you know, negative, you know, whatever, when it comes to NGOs. But why we look at these guys like this? Huh? Why we are skeptical? Maybe they're better than the state, maybe they're better than the, you know, non-government organizations. If they're better, we should really work with them and get better results. My NGOs also make profits. In a different way, maybe. Maybe the profits will go back to the community, I'm sure. But profit making, what is the problem with the profit making? I'm happy, I get 24 hours of, you know, water supply, cheaper price, and if they make, even then they make profits, why should I worry? Let them make profits. I'm happy they're giving me 24 hours, you know, water access with the less price, a better quality. So why should I worry that they're making profits? Because they're not putting their money back, or they're becoming rich. They're going to 5-star hotels. I'm still, you know, here in this planet. Somehow I think it's been created. But the point I'm highlighting is, in Malaysia it seems the POPs privatization has given a lot of, you know, stigma or whatever you call it, or skepticism regarding private sector. Maybe we need to be more careful when we talk about them, when we work with them. Maybe this is the best alley or best, you know, sector that we should work with and then get the benefits. Why not? Okay, you get profits, I get the better services, win-win. Recently I said, no, I've written a proposal on dyslexic children. There are 1 million dyslexic children. I need an industry support letter to get this funding from the Ministry of Science and Technology. It's a must, but I didn't get an industry, you know, to who can support me. But that was an interesting project actually. If an industry, a private sector, part of this project, then my project would get more points. Why the government is asking private sector? Because maybe they can scale it up. Maybe they bring, you know, more business principles, cost effectiveness, quality, I don't know. Our industry should be involved in projects like this, the knowledge transfer, you know, projects. Or they learn the knowledge that has been created in universities and they commercialize and make more profits, or, you know, we produce more. It's a production or productivity, you know, kind of approach, but it's good. But I didn't find, of course, that's another reason. But why not? So I'm asking you to understand the very role that the private sector plays into social services like water service. It's very interesting. We need to understand this more detail. I'll move on. Okay, this is what their company looks like. Again, I'm taking this from their website. And I like this. They have a center called Aidam Team Building Center. I think we can also use that. They're beautiful on that side. It's a nice green, you know, training center where trainings can be taking place. They use that for the team building and the company or whatever training programs. They call it Water Academy or something like that. There is something there. Water supply training. So they have their own training unit where they train their own staff, team building efforts, a lot of things. You look at that, everything they have. Penang Water Limited, Spring Water, the theme parks or whatever, maybe things like that. PVA resources, look at that. It's a public company with, I think, government holds 55% of the shares. The rest of the shares with the PVA. Maybe government is earning more than they actually prioritize like this. So that, you know, that money can be invested in many other projects if possible. I don't know exactly. We need to kind of really look into this. the access, the surveys, the pricing that people in Penang have paid. Now, as Rosina says, in this government, the water price has come down, it seems. We need to look at last 20 years, for example. Before privatization, after privatization, how people feel. Maybe they feel cut out, they feel, you know, excluded, or they're feeling the pinch of it, I don't know. You can see that. This is another table I've taken from 2004 study. Public Works Department still plays an important role in Kedah, Sarawak, Labuan, and Perlis. Whereas Water Supply Department plays an important role in Pahang, Semelia, and Sabah. Whereas in Pulau Pinang, you can see that water supply companies, that's what in BABB. You know, slowly I think all the states in Malaysia will be privatized, I'm sure. It's happening. It's privatized in the year 2000. Production and distribution by PBA Holdings. State government share is about 55%. It gives a very important, interesting picture of how the states in Malaysia are actually going towards that. Some states are fully privatized. Which are there? The provision of water services. These include the more developed states, what I was saying, in terms of GDP, such as Selangor, Pulau Pinang, and Johor. In most cases, the state government continues to hold equity in the privatized water entities, equity, the 55% or whatever, but the production and other things are in the hands of the private company. They make decisions, they make sure that they get also profits and also maybe, you know, better services, we are not sure. So what I'm trying to tell you here is just a overview of what is happening. And water supply, access to drinking water is a basic, you know, service. It's a very important social policy in any way, water. You know? And now this is what's happening in that sector. Okay, now let's look at what's happening in education a little bit. I'm sure you're already aware of this because you yourself, Ms. Bala. 20 public universities and 40 private universities. What is the impact of this on the tertiary education or higher education in Malaysia? Is it good, is it bad, or why is that happening? Why we had, I mean, like Nepal, as I said, 28 million, 30 million, Malaysia, they have only 5 universities, all state, no public, no private as of now. But definitely one day they will come. It's happening everywhere. In India, there are a lot of private universities now, everywhere. Why is this happening? Is it good, bad? Same fee that you pay here, maybe a private university provides better teachers, better classrooms, better whatever, or what is this? Look at this. Percentage distribution of number of establishments by industry, the private sector, you know. There are a lot of kindergartens, other schools, driving schools, music, colleges and universities, commercial and others. Technical institutes, secondary schools, primary schools, they're everywhere. There's nowhere that they're not there. Universities, for example. The state with the highest number of establishments in private education sector was Selangor. So we should go to Selangor and stay there. You know, the water is privatized, the education is privatized, you know, everything is privatized so that, you know, maybe there's better. Why do you think Selangor is like that? Any idea? Who's from Selangor? Is it because very close to KL?
Yes. One of the factors, there's a lot of people who say that. And then there's a lot
Selangor is opposition, right?
Yes. It is the center of Malaysia.
It's the center of Malaysia, it's an opposition state, it's very close to KL,
yeah.
Lot of facilities. Or the opposition states are more interested in privatization because they can claim that look, we are privatized, we are modern, we are services are better. Is that the reason they privatize a lot compared to other? There must be something happening there. what do you think? The health, the education services better in Selangor compared to other states? Yes. And if it is because of the private sector, then we should, you know, recognize. Maybe we should learn from that and implement in other states also. So this is the main difference. When it is a private or it's a public, it looks like this is a slide, you know, that there has been a steady growth of private sector participation in education. We agree now. There are also attempts at government level for public-private partnerships, PPP, which also there is interesting discussions on that. While traditionally it was government's obligation to provide education to all, universal education, universal access to education, but they are actually giving this duty to the private sector or non-governmental sector or whatever. The entry of private sector has brought with it a new market dimension. What is this new market dimension? What do you think? The entry of private sector into higher education or even private education or whatever. What new market, you know, dimension that they brought? Is it quality is better? What do you think? You're in a public, you're a public university. What would have been different if you would have been a Katin or if you would have been a, if you would have been a, what are those private, you know? I mean, Seji or Sambe or, you know? What would have been the difference? I am the same teacher, even if it is the private college, maybe I will teach the same. Maybe they will pay me a little bit more. Yeah. They ask me to publish more. I don't know. Maybe a small number of students. Maybe I have to teach, you know, 4 courses. I don't know. What would have been the difference? Really, do you think there would have been any difference?
Yeah, actually, like private university, for example, I can tell you, or you have also University of Malaysia. I have experience teaching the students there. They are actually, they are money oriented, they want money. And then I have gone through experience where I can't pay for, they still have public price, they waste it.
I heard about that. Even students demand, look, I am paying a high fee and your salary comes from my fees, why are you giving low marks? It seems they were behaving like that, I'm not sure. But I was told by someone who is working in here. You know, I was asking him, what do you think, how their life looks like? He said, no, horrible. Students are very arrogant. I'm not sure, I don't have evidence, but it's possible. But then what is then, why is that our state is going for private universities like anything? The cost should have been less, the quality should have been more compared to the state, or there must be something, some rationale, some reasoning behind privatizing the higher education. If the students are, you know, much more whatever. But what else they are offering there? Please? Seems you cannot offer a diploma. It first came in the conference also, remember? We need diploma on social workers, postgraduate diploma on social workers, certificate social workers. But then unfortunately, universities like USM cannot start. But there is a demand for that. So someone has to do this. So maybe this is where the private universities will come in. I'm sure, yeah, you're right. But then maybe after some time, assuming growth of private sector, a lot of competition, whatever led to, you know, unethical practices, possible.
The original purpose was like writing certificates,
and possible. And more migrant workers like me prefer so-called international schools. I don't know. There is always this push and pull factors.
Yeah.
There must be a study actually available to look at the, you know, the very contribution of the private higher education. But it seems these are the main, you know, salient features when it comes to public and private, and we see this in the Malaysian education system, for example. The focus in private is individual, because less high-paying students are supposed to be individual. Whereas in public universities, the focus will be on group. Methodology will be learner-centered. Whereas in public, learning-centered. What is that? Maybe Rosalina can explain to us. Huh? Learner-centered and learning-centered. What is the difference? Very interesting. The learner wants. Maybe it is audio learning, visual learning, kinetic learning, you know. So, for example, if you're interested in audio, okay, you get that. If you're interested in visual learning, yes. Whereas in public universities, it says it's a learning-centered, just one method. You know, is that correct? Just one way, or just lecture method, and that's it, not more than that. Whereas assessments, non-reference, whereas the criteria reference, norm reference, norm, Montessori, you know. When you finish certain grades, you can actually be promoted. Whereas in public universities or public institutions, it is a criteria, 79, 80, you know, A+, B+, whatever. So excellence and equity, so you can understand this, supposed to be. But there must be blurring somewhere, you know. Maybe now public universities are also talking about excellence, also, you know, together with the equity, you know. They're also talking about excellence. There also a lot of decentralization we can see in public universities now. Like USM, a lot of decisions we can take at the section level. And then we go to the school, school makes a lot of decisions. It's happening here also. So it's not that clear-cut divisions, but this is one argument why private institutions, you know, should be promoted. Because they're competitive, there's a focus on individual learning, it's learning centered, it's an excellence based, you know, it's decentralized, it's top down, whatever. Look at this, private is very top down, you know, because the decisions are taken there, cost cuttings or whatever, the fee structure, whatever, and public is bottom up. You know, there are a lot of discussions we do here, we send our recommendations to the vice chancellor, maybe, you know. So, you see advantages and disadvantages in both the systems. But the reality in Malaysia is now there are 40, you know, universities offering different services and courses. And who is accessible? You know, can everyone have an access to these universities? What is the quality? You know, what contribution do they, you know, actually do when it comes to the overall higher learning? We need to look at that. So that is what education. Maybe we go into more details. Can we stop now? But now that we are discussing, let me go back. Yeah, thank you, Hassan, for that interesting, you know, classification of evolution of social policy during, I mean, three major periods in the last 50 years. Let us go and see what's happening in public health, and then maybe we can understand a little bit more what's happening in terms of private sector actors in Malaysian social policy space. Yeah, what do you think? I think also we discussed this already in earlier classes. We see a lot of three sections, right? One, the state-owned. The other one is public sector, private sector, or private and medical health facilities. I think that in between is the hybrid. It is the state, but offering in a private mode. What is it called? I think a state government investing into, you know, a chain of hospitals where you go and, you know, pay our usual charges or something like that. Remember last time we were discussing? Is it state of Johor is investing into health?
Yeah.
What is that known? KPC? Yeah, so the BP, I mean, state you know, providing services in a hybrid form. So what is the advantage of that? So basically, do you call it private sector, you call it, you know, semi-governmental, or what do you call it? What is that we can learn from? So I have few slides here. I'll show the slides now. We have half an hour. So Malaysian health policy, if you look at it, is reforming, and it's about all about financing the medical care, which is a very important, you know, how do we finance? Is it state or it's public? Is it public-private? Whatever. So it's also a very complex situation that you have when it comes to Malaysian care system and healthcare system, and we need to understand when it comes to rural, kampung, and urban. And it's also different from peninsular Malaysia to Sabah, Sarawak. So very different, you know, situation. But it's very important for us to understand how much is being spent. Then what is the, you know, kind of people are writing about this in the media. This is the KBZ, which we are discussing. Whether it is cheaper, better, or what does that mean when the government is involved into this. Eye care. Then what we mean by, you know, how is this healthcare is being financed. People are talking about sustainable healthcare financing. I can also, I think this is a very important thing we can discuss. It helps us to understand the four different, you know, sectors and nature when it comes to, you know, private, public. You know, I think we'll discuss this. There's something called free market. Why we should involve or promote free market. Especially you know, basic services like health. We'll also talk about this, how this, like, you know, when it comes to industry, how this, you know, resources and the infrastructure, human resources moving towards rich countries. So a lot of literature has already been written, how do we work with private sector providers in better healthcare, because they have different advantages. There are a lot of things written up actually. What additional incentives that will bring when we involve private sector or privatization in a basic health facilities or medical care? Global Health Watch, there's an alternative World Health Report which talks about, you know, all these non-traditional indigenous and care services. So what we are trying to understand today is maybe across these three periods, we are talking about not just welfare state, but welfare pluralism. When I say welfare pluralism, it's not just state, it's not just private sector, it's not just family, it's not just, you know, your mutual aid, but there are a lot of institutions that are involved. Pluralism. You know, pluralism is different actors, different institutions that are acting in the same space, you know, which we call it welfare pluralism. I think that's the last slide. So that is what, that's where we end. Okay, so it's not much, we can do it in half an hour. Okay. What do you think? Market-oriented healthcare. What is your view about that? And it is started in second phase, right? That is 1987?
Yeah, mid-1980s
to 1980s. 82, yeah, to the crisis. Any idea about that? Or what is your view about accessing healthcare services in your own villages, in your own, now you must be having, you know, some idea about that. Some idea about One Care Malaysia clinics, or how this KPJ works, or how private hospitals are working. What is your view? Have you been, I'm sure you must have been fallen ill, and all your family members. What are the difficulties in accessing? What do you think about medical care in Malaysia now, compared to say 10 years ago or 15 years ago, when you were chair? Is better? More options? Or what do you think about this insurance and related to over medicalization, what do you call? Prescriptive prescribing, you know, overstay in hospitals because you have insurance, so that the insurance will pay more to the hospitals. Over medicalization, over prescribing, over medicines. What do you think? Have you heard about these things?
I think overall, the medical service rendered by the private sector is much improved.
So 10, 15 years ago?
Yes. Because one of the...
All this is improved?
schools. But government employees, they would mostly go to the government hospitals. Private employees would go to private hospitals simply because they are being insured.
Insurance.
And that's where it comes to the insurance companies started to play their role in inverted comma of
over medicalization.
And overclaiming of the thing provided. But because the facilities owned by the government sector is much more improved, there are cases they are being referred from the private sector
to public sector.
And another reason is because the government sector can afford at a very minimal cost. Some big surgeries and all this is being carried on in the government sector and not in public. That is also a challenge for private sector to grow in the Malaysia.
And that's why they, maybe cost efficient or better services, competing for better human resources. Medical tourism, for example, is growing just because maybe the private sector wants to tap that opportunity because it's a worldwide phenomenon now. You get better services for low price, so people from US, UK, Indonesia comes to Malaysia or India.
One simple example why almost 80% of childbirth is taking place in government hospitals.
It is safe, free, or whatever.
So
is that better? What do you think? Maybe it seems that the doctors who are working in government sector cannot work in private sector even after their office hours or whatever, which is not the case in India, for example. They're allowed, some countries, It seems there is an impact of that rule on people leaving public sector permanently and going to the private sector. That's how the private sector attracts the best doctors, a lot of doctors compared to, public sector. So what do you think? The privatization in the lives of all of us. Better, not better, maybe in some cases better, some cases not better. In Penang, there are 27, dialysis centers.
Yes.
Not in public. They're all private, NGOs, Buddhists, Muslim, What do you think? 27, more than that it seems. What was the reason for that? If the services are better in a public hospital, why do they go to a private dialysis center? Or they call people who come to their house and provide their service at their house, dialysis. The reasons are more, alcoholic and many things. We are not going into that, but we are talking about the services that are available. They said people can pay more so that they can get people come to their house and do these services. Or is it very bad that when they go to public hospitals, or what is this? I mean, why is this growth in the last 10-15 years? A lot of investments available, banks are interested in putting money into this. There must be something. At the end, as social policy, as social workers, we should ask this question: is this really good for each Malaysian? Who is earning even less than 700 ringgits per month, which is supposed to be basic minimum wage. And I think Penang is 760, in some states it's less than that. Is it good for everyone, the system that we have in Malaysia? Or it's not really working for the really poor. It's only working for the middle and the higher middle and the rich. If that is the case, what is that we should argue and advocate for? Private sector existence and health, education, water is necessary.
Yes.
Okay. Even in water.
I'm not sure. If we talk about Penang, those who can afford, they go to private. Those who can't afford, they go to government. And the government does not restrict those who go to private.
When you say afford, it means what? 1,700, 2,000, 3,000, what is that you're referring to?
Personally, those
Yeah, that's like 3,000 plus income. More than that. So, okay, that's okay, another point.
I believe that privatization
provides
alternative choice for the citizen. Because people can choose whether they want to go to a private healthcare provider or to go to the government. And because that's what, like I was to say, people are willing to pay to get better services. They are entitled to get what the government provides for them. But some of us feel that what the government provides is not good enough. So they are willing to pay more just to get what they feel a better service and a better.
Willingness is there, but do you think you are willing to pay and you are paying more, but do you think you are really getting worth the money in private sector or private hospitals? Just when it comes to over medicalization or over claiming, over prescribing or whatever.
It's not happening for every case.
It's not happening, do you think?
No,
so?
It's happening, but not for every case.
Okay.
It's not for every case.
But do you think you see the same treatment when a UK or a Indonesian comes to the same private hospital and getting treated, and you as a Malaysian, you know, middle income, whatever, go to the same hospital? Do you think you get the same attention, same quality of services?
In my personal opinion, when we go to a private hospital, we can choose what we want. If we want to get a special doctor, if you want to get a diagnosis, we can choose whether we want to get the diagnosis or not. Whereas in a government sector, sometimes we are not allowed to choose. When we say that I want to get diagnosis or anything, but they will tell us what to do. You have to wait.
It's not possible, maybe because of the number of clients or number of patients they have to serve, and also the number of resources they have. The point here is, for example, only 3% of the households are poor. So why should we have public hospitals here? We should close them. Because everyone is, I've heard, 1 billion and can pay.
No, the affordability.
This is not a poor state, it's a high developing state. Not a developing state.
Yeah. But still, we can't privatize the whole medical sector.
Water we did? We did water, finance state did the water's. Almost, I think it's fully privatized to PAPB. It serves how many? 64 or I don't know how much is percentage. Almost all, 100%.
Because the cost of private healthcare is high. So not everyone, especially like older citizens.
So what if we privatize and the cost is less? Like in, the government pays for the private sector to certain grants and the cost is low. Okay, we are talking is actually the models, right?
For example, I agree with my lady's. It's a choice that I personally make, even though I can go to government hospital. It's deliberately a personal choice I make. And I felt the service I got is equivalent to those who came from foreign countries, like in Africa, in Asia, in Thailand, all those things, same one. I got the best.
Some people are saying in private hospitals there is a difference in treatment because medical tourism is high and they get a lot of money compared to a Malaysian patient. So these are issues are there. What we are trying to understand is private sector or medical care is being privatized for whatever reasons. We can see that in policy. Those shifts are evident, but is it good for every Malaysian, especially those poor, the residual poor? If not, we have to do something with the social policy, as a student of social policy. We'll move away a little bit and see what's happening in terms of the literature that we have. Market-oriented healthcare is happening everywhere. When we say market-oriented or private healthcare, what does that mean? In market-oriented medical care, the patient is the customer. We were talking about that. He's a customer, he's a client, Customer is God, that kind of service. He's everything, because he's paying. The patient is the customer, and the medical care and service rendered by the doctor or the hospital is the commodity. You're buying the commodity, Maybe we don't talk about these things when it comes to public hospitals. You're not a customer there, you're a patient, you're treated, So you're a customer, there is a commodity relationship, A commodity and service is traded in a demand and a supply chain. as you said, private hospitals are good, KPCA for example. No? It's good if it brings pressure on the public services. At the same time, they're also, you know, have to maintain, you know, the quality services, price, you know, when there is a public thing. So the beautiful mix of both may be good. Maybe we are trying to, you know, agree on that. But this is what happens when a market-oriented healthcare. As a user, as a client, you have choices. The patient, main desire is to secure the best doctor, best service, best medicine, best hospital facilities, and the best attendance or, you know, a paramedical support and related personal caring services. And that's supposed to happen. It may be happening, we don't know. Maybe we need to look at another studies. So, and the patient's hope to purchase, the willingness to pay, all of these at the lowest possible medical cost, you know, compared to the public or even civil society or services, for example. So we have three players here: the patient or the citizen, maybe Malaysian or non-Malaysian or whatever, the healthcare provider, KPCA or whatever, and the healthcare purchaser. Here you have three markets. One is the service, the healthcare service, the expert, the doctor, and the purchase markets, the insurance and many others. This is what I think, if we can understand these six, you know, things, then we will be able to understand what is this market is all about, or what is about private medical care is all about. So we don't see these things in a public thing, because the service provider, the state, and the patient is the main, you know, actors there. If you just trying to understand the health policy of Malaysia, it's all about reforming and financing. As we can see, governments throughout the world, not only in Malaysia, are increasingly realizing the value of developing health systems, because it's basics, Millennium Development Goals or whatever, that provide healthcare while financially protecting the people in the fairest way possible. So that means the people can spend as little as possible for the best service available. 584 million children and young people live in South Asia, for example. The largest number of children and young people under 18 in any region, constituting between 30 to 50% of the population of the individual, and we can see what's happening to, for example, children and their health, women and their health, disability and their health, you know, old people and their health. I think these are the things, again, we need to look into when we talk about medical health care or private medical care. Are they investing on that? Do we have enough services when it comes to children and private medical care? Where is this private medical care is concentrated? Is it a heart, is it kidney, and what kind of services that we see? Do you think you go to a private medical care when it comes to a fever, normal fever? No. A cough or some headache? You don't go to private medical care. Why? Many people, right? They agree? For small diseases or, you know, like this, fever, cough, but a kidney transplantation, a heart transplantation, or a brain surgery, we go to private. Why is that? Is it specialization, or it's more difficult, or you think that is the best place to go? But whereas fever, diarrhea, and cholera or whatever, HIV/AIDS, also, is there any private medical care for HIV/AIDS?
All
general hospitals, but what about private hospitals? Are they really focusing on this? No, because it's the poor people who have HIV and they can't pay, so there's no point, you know, providing this service. Is that correct? Do you think we go to a private hospital for a TB, tuberculosis? No, we go to the private or public? You have a leprosy or something like that, you don't know about it and that, you don't put it. So private is actually specialized, because that is where the money or that's where the services are needed, and that's where maybe they bring relevant people and infrastructure, medical infrastructure. Well, so that's what, you know.
And it is also depends on the state and the area where there is the availability of private hospitals.
No.
When we talk about Penang, yes, the island has gotten a lot of private hospitals. Because
of the colonial season
where the British came, they opened up the hospitals and all those things. But if you look at states like in, even in Korea or in Korea, or Plata, the availability of private hospitals are very less.
But why?
Because private hospitals, to a certain extent, they are profit
So these services are only available in so-called developed states. People can pay, and yeah, and that's where the you know the more number of cardiovascular diseases or obesity or kidney or whatever. So you're higher rich, you're more rich, you're more prone to these expensive diseases. That's why you know these expensive private hospitals. Do you like that? No, it's not like that. Demand is
people are able to pay for
it. So there's demand. So basically then you see a lot of private hospitals in those highly developed states in Malaysia. What we are trying to understand here is what are the drivers? Now why Malaysian health policy has to talk about this? No? Especially in the 80s and the second stage of social policy that Nazir talked about. During that time there were a lot of privatization. During that time there were a lot of privatization even in the medical sector. Medical, one of the basic, for a state to provide, free health and free education. Even then, the states like Penang are actually promoting, or even the whole Malaysia is actually promoting to some extent. We can see that the evidence, the private medical care, because they think now many people can pay and afford, so it's better that these people go to private so that the poor people will get better services because there is less. Caseloads are less on the public, so that even public hospitals can serve better. So what are the drivers of the health policy in Malaysia? Now we can see that the drivers or the factors that are influencing maybe willingness to pay, people who can pay, and better services, or maybe infrastructure or human resources availability, the history, whatever Sumati was saying. So there's so many drivers, local and global, is actually leading to private medical care, which has impacts, influence on an average Malaysian. So healthcare financing or healthcare financing reforms is the path towards improved health system performance. That's what our policy believes in. And maybe I don't know what is this, but I think he's talking about that. What is this? Scope of services. Supposed to be, these are all services that are comes under our Malaysian health policy, and where private sector is playing an important role in this services. Yeah, this is the complex system that we have. We have private sectors and NGOs also, private healthcare facilities, private hospitals, private medical practitioner clinics, estate, mines, hospitals. Maybe it's related to FELTA, I don't know. Clinics and factories and industries, others, dental practitioner, pharmacists, laboratories, x-ray surgeries, nursing homes, medical schools, traditional alternative medicine practitioners. A lot of things happening in the private sector. And there's an act also, which governs the private hospitals and private care services. It's a separate act, that you see there. So that means it's the reality is there, and we need to understand its influence on the overall health policy. So you can also see the medical tourism, the improvement of medical tourism. We already discussed Penang, Malacca, and Johor Bahru are the fabric destinations for this medical tourism. Maybe it's closer to Indonesia, I don't know why is that, or the history. 35 private hospitals are earmarked to participate in the promotion of medical tourism in the country. Medical tourism has to be developed as a nationally committed project. It's now part of our policy that we will promote medical tourism, which consists of decent national budgets rather than what individual private hospitals can afford to spend. That means private hospitals where they're attracting this medical tourism are also asking for national budgets. It's like promoting tourism using the national budgets by the private operators. We have to think in terms of a national instead of a private enterprise. So we can go into more into this. We You can see 5% from Japan, 10% of the medical tourism comes from Singapore, 3% from Europe, even India. They're very interested to me actually, you know. 4% because of their connections here, families here, I don't know. You know, others 6%, Indonesia is the highest, 72%, you know. Malaysia needs a substantial health financial mechanisms because Malaysian national health accounts shows that Malaysians have steadily increased their healthcare spending around 35 billion per year. So the health spending is also increasing. So that's why doctors, you know, they're asking for a sustainable healthcare financing system which will not drain on the other resources. You have this KPZ Healthcare, a leading private healthcare service provider in the region with a network of 20 hospitals in Malaysia and 2 in Indonesia. There is eye care. Malaysians will probably have to pay 6 to 10% of their monthly income in contributions to One Care Fund. Any idea about this One Care Fund? It's for whom? For everyone or it's only for low income families? Can anyone go to Malaysia One Clinics or it's just a limited services? Or do we go if we don't go?
It's for everyone. Okay. It's for everyone, but what is contradicting there is we already have been having all the community level clinics all the while, and what's going to be new about this clinic population? That's a contradicting objective. Of
do you think it's a duplication of?
Yeah.
Okay. What? There must be some other.
Promoting the policy of one Malaysia.
One Malaysia is part of that. It's part of that is one care. Any other ideas on that? No? Have you been to Mankir, Malaysia, the clinics ever? Where do you go?
One
care
shop. One Malaysia shop.
I'm struggling to find a place because, you know, I can't bring my family to the clinic. I was told I can also go here. It's only a 12 ringgits or 10 ringgits usual charges for us. It's called non-Malaysians. But it's cheaper than private health, you know. Clinics. So we'll provide massive public subsidies for private hospitals. It is saying, look, this will our health policy will provide massive public subsidies for private hospitals. We need to understand this. That's where the medical tourism and all that, you know. Actually, private hospitals are asking for national budgets. You know, payments out of the National Healthcare Authority funds. Raised from public via taxes, monthly public contributions, will serve as a large subsidies to boost admissions, the occupancy, and the bottom line of private hospitals and GLC owned private hospitals. What is GLC? Government?
Large company.
Huh? Is it GLC? I think there are a lot of talk about GLC. Government lease companies? Huh? Government licensed companies. I try to find out the acronym, but everywhere there's GLCs. This is where, you know, the Fox, the false privatization, whatever. One Care is restructured national health system that is responsive and provides choice of quality health care. That's what it says. Ensuring universal coverage for healthcare needs of population based on solidarity and equity. What is that? Concerns is always there wherever government want to implement something, and that thing is managed solely by government.
A company.
What is that?
A government-linked company.
Government-linked company.
There is 10 GLC companies in Malaysia.
How many?
10.
Okay.
Telecom Malaysia,
CNB, which is being practiced, Sain Garvey, CIMB, Bank, and so on. So what do you think? What is their impact? What is their, you know, role in social services? So maybe we'll move on. I can see that. So basically, how can we conclude this? Maybe I just talk about this. Maybe this will stop. Can you see what is your you have public financing, the state, and you have private financing. You know, maybe I don't have insurance, I pay out of my pocket straight away, you know, private in financing. I don't go to, I still go to private, I could have gone to public, no need to pay, but still I go to private and pay from my pocket. So public financing and private financing, you have public provision of the state and you have private provision, the private market. What happens when public financing and public provision? Government funding and provision free at point of use. Public financing and public provision. Basically our government, not state, you know, public hospitals. Whereas public financing and private provision. Yes. As you can see, South Korea and Germany. Now this is where, you know, the government invests into medical, but you know the services are by the private, where your income tax thing, you know. The contract of healthcare delivery to private providers, please come in, but the government pays for it. So what is the difference between this and this? Which one is better? It's a public funding and public provision. Basically the money comes from government and it's a government hospital. Whereas KBJ, you know, the money comes from the government but with the private services. It's better? Or it's a private financing and public provision. Okay, I still go to a public hospital but I pay more and get a better bed or a service, you know, ward. Now I think there are different wards. You can pay for according to your thing. For even a public hospital, I can get better services by paying more. Is that better for us? Or this is better? It's fully publicly funded but privately managed. Everyone goes to there. Or is this better? I go to a public hospital but I pay a little bit more and get a better ward and a different ward. Or I do a private financing and private, fully private, you know, what we are talking about. Basically this and this we are talking about, right? The public, we know, you know, it's like public hospital and this is private hospitals. Whereas these two are different, you know, a little different. I think we need to look into that. Maybe, you know, there are options here. I think in our government hospitals now it has come already. That's what I've seen some literature. There are different wards where you can pay differently and you get different services. So already there, maybe this is what our private hospitals are asking about. Okay, you give us a little bit money because we are serving medical tourism. We can bring more medical tourists, which bring more dollars or whatever foreign exchange. So you fund us so that we bring more. You know? So all these things I think we see in medical care, medical services in Malaysia. And as social policy students, we need to ask questions. Is it really good for an average Malaysian, a Malaysian whose income is less than 700 ringgits per month, where he or she fits in, which model will provide better services? And this is where it is leading to pluralism, welfare pluralism. Yeah. Earlier it's public, fully public, and at this it's fully, you know, private or strictly about the, you know, profits. Now we are, what looking at it is exploring the middle path, social enterprise. For example, the state is also looking at results, outputs, efficiency, whereas at the same time the private also looking for socially responsible business so that they can do more business, they're committed more. So that is the place where I think a lot of things can happen. And this is called welfare pluralism. Not just one state, not just private sector, not just NGOs, but a host of institutions come together, family, come together and offer welfare services, which is the best. And it's happening already. For certain medical health education, you pay and offer out of the pocket. Right? Maybe straight away. For certain services are fully free, we use them. Certain services we have to get from the private hospitals. Maybe they're also talking about socially responsible business and where the costs are reduced because there is, you know, government support. So this is the thing that are happening in welfare, you know, in any country that includes Malaysia. Maybe this is where we need to understand. So welfare pluralism is a concept, a term that is used to describe a reduced role for a state intervention in welfare and greater emphasis on voluntary action, NGOs, civil society, informal aid and the market. where the private sector is coming. So I think what we can carry from today is the message that medicine, medical care, education, this is what we can understand, the welfare pluralism. It is there and we need to understand this.